There are still privileged places where nature continues on its way, changes and evolves as it always has. Places such as the Doñana National Park in southern Spain, where hundreds of species live governed only by the laws of nature and the pace of the changing seasons. But what happens when unchecked human activity alters these conditions? What happens if we reduce the spaces, if we change the climate, if we eradicate those species that bother us or get in our way? What would happen if the Iberian lynx disappeared? Dr. Astrid Vargas does not want that question to ever be answered. At the El Acebuche Breeding and Captivity Center in Doñana National Park, she directs the team in charge of carrying out this ambitious project of turning a dream into reality. With the sponsorship of the regional government of Andalusia and the Ministry of the Environment, the collaboration of numerous feline breeding centers around the world, and the support and backing of the entire population in the area around the park, a project has been carried out here since 2003 with the aim of breeding a sufficient number of lynxes to be able to reintroduce them into the wild. Accompanied by Dr. Astrid Vargas, director of the Ex Situ Conservation Project, we're going to find out about the extraordinary work done by this select group of Spanish scientists and see the advances that have been achieved, the dangers that still remain, and just how far science has come in its endeavor to save the lynx. The alarm bells that began ringing in the mid-1980s, predicting the rapid disappearance of the Iberian lynx, were finally answered on the 28th of March 2005, when the first litter of lynxes was born in captivity. Brecina, Brezo, and Brisa represented the culmination of a great deal of work, and above all, the starting point for a project that will end in 2010. But the birth of these cubs does not mean the problem is solved. The Iberian lynx is still in extreme danger of extinction. There is always the threat of a poacher, poison, a fatal road accident, or a disease that decimates the small populations of lynxes that still survive in Doñana and Sierra Morena. The birth of that litter, along with the financial aid from the regional government of Andalusia, and the progress made by the El Acebuche Center in the study of lynxes, all augur well for the future. The dream of saving the lynx can be achieved. Before telling the story of how a group of scientists is trying to prevent the Iberian lynx from disappearing from our forests, we are going to discover the privileged setting which human beings have managed to preserve from their own activities so that the fauna of the Iberian Peninsula can survive. The river Guadalquivir, at the point at which it pours into the Atlantic Ocean in southwest Andalusia, has created a series of ecosystems that have together been declared a World Heritage Site. Entering from the sea, we discover 30 kilometers of virgin beaches. The sands, blown by the wind, accumulate on the scrubland, creating dunes that grow, invading the interior. The slow advance of these constantly changing mountains gradually covers the vegetation and encircles green, humid areas that are full of life called corrales. The movement of the dunes is one of the best examples of how nature is constantly changing, endlessly evolving. In a few years, the humid scrublands will be engulfed by an enormous mountain of sand, while what now looks like a desert will once again be covered in vegetation. A other changes that are easier to appreciate take place in the most extensive characteristic area of the national park, the wetlands. These are extensive areas of clayey soil, which during the summer perhaps remind us of the desolate landscapes of the African deserts. And nonetheless, with the appearance of the rains, they are completely transformed and come to life. The impermeable sands make it possible for the waters to flood the wetlands for many months of the year. Depending on the quantity of water accumulated, we will find areas of marsh vegetation, shallow pools, and grazing pasture. The cattails and common reeds that colonize the wetlands comprise the dominant vegetation in this largest bird sanctuary in Europe. Of landscape is to be found at the point of contact between the sands of the beaches and the clays of the wetlands. Known as the vera, they are humid places covered in pasture and bulrushes. Stretch the cotos, large expanses of Mediterranean forest and scrubland, where cork trees alternate with pines, junipers with rock roses, rosemary and lavender, heather and brambles. Whereas in the wetlands we can observe teeming bird life, the cotos are the realm of the amphibians and the mammals, and the ideal place for the Iberian lynx to live. Unfortunately, ideal habitats like those of Doñana are fast disappearing from the map. With the reduction of the forests, the lynx population have become isolated, which has led to endogamy with the resulting weakening of the species. To this must be added the fact that successive epidemics of myxomatosis and viral hemorrhage disease have decimated the rabbit population, which makes up 90% of the lynx's diet. Together, these circumstances have turned the Iberian lynx into the most threatened feline on the planet. In the past 25 years, its population has fallen spectacularly, and during the 1990s, the threat of extinction seemed closer than ever. In addition, given the lack of food, it came dangerously close to inhabited areas, where it came into contact with wildcats from which it caught diseases against which it had no defense. There were frequent encounters with dogs, and as if that wasn't enough, it brushed up against its worst enemy. Man has not been a good neighbor for the wolf or the bear, and our treatment of the lynx would be no different. Human activity is contrary to the interests of the lynx. Even in privileged environments like Doñana, the list of dangers is endless. The cars on the roads, the poisoned bait set to control other species, and it is still even possible to find poachers. On the other hand, farmers and cattle herders need to fence off their lands, bring in machines to work their fields, use fertilizers, and move their cattle and horses around. And there is also the problem of territoriality. The Iberian lynx needs space in which to live, And in times of great urban developments and the construction of motorways, that is a luxury even for humans. And we can make do with 2 or 3 bedroom flats, whereas a lynx needs a territory of between 4 and 5 square kilometers. But the factors that lead to the eradication of the species are fortunately reversible. If the hand of man lies behind all of them, the aim must be to turn the main destroyer of nature into a civilized being who respects his surroundings. In short, we need a change of mentality.
One important aspect is educating the people in the area where lynxes are going to be reintroduced, making them aware so that there is total support from the local population. The people in the surrounding area have to be in agreement and back the reintroduction. If not, they will boycott the reintroduction and the lynx will not be able to continue.
The low numbers of Iberian lynxes and the scarce and distant distribution of these led the Nature Conservation Commission to approve in February 2001 a program for the conservation of the species ex situ, that is, away from its natural habitat. The place chosen to carry out this project was the El Acebuche Center in Doñana National Park, and the person in charge of directing it was Dr. Astrid Vargas. The primordial objective is to achieve a population of 70 lynxes in captivity and then begin to reintroduce them in places where in the past there were lynxes in the wild. Males and females from litters of over 3 cubs born in the wild are brought to these facilities so they can adapt to their new home and procreate with the lynxes bred here. The captured animals undergo quarantine to prevent them from passing diseases onto the other animals in the center. During this period, all kinds of measurements and analyses are carried out, and they begin a period of adaptation to their new life in captivity.
The first adult male to enter the breeding program, Garfio, adapted perfectly, and he was an animal that had lived for over 3 years in the wild. However, we have animals that came here at the age of 6 or 7 months, and it has taken them a year and a half to adapt.
Thanks to the installation of an extensive network of fixed and mobile cameras, the team can keep a constant watch on the lives of the animals in captivity. It is not only a question of studying them, but also of protecting them. And the best way to do that is by maintaining exhaustive vigilance, but also a distance that enables the animals to feel at ease.
What we try to ensure is that the animals are not stressed in the presence of their carers. We avoid domestication from all points of view. We don't want to have lynxes that can be touched nor that are excessively accustomed to humans. But we do want lynxes that don't get nervous in the presence of their carers. Another thing is what we're going to do with the future animals that are going to be reintroduced, and their contact with humans will be absolutely minimal, so it's a different kind of handling.
Doñana National Park is a World Heritage Site, a biosphere reserve, and a center of special interest for bird watching. Its wetlands are among the most important in Europe. Thousands of birds stop off here on their endless migrations between the cold north and the eternal summer of the tropics. When the wetlands flood, we can see the most representative images of Doñana Park. Pairs of anatids quietly swim around its waters, while the waders, such as the herons or the unmistakable flamingos, scrabble in the mud in search of food. If the lynx is king on land, the imperial eagle is the master of the air in Doñana, and unfortunately, it is also in danger of extinction. Other specially protected birds are three species of anatids: the ferruginous duck, the ruddy shell duck, and the extremely rare white-headed duck. And the pink flamingo, which in recent years has bred in the park. Between the scrubland and the wetlands stand the Doñana aviaries, large old cork oaks that we could say are the avian maternity rooms of Doñana. Their branches offer a truly amazing spectacle. Herons, egrets, spoonbills, and even birds of prey like the short-toed eagle have built their nests here and form colonies, sometimes of thousands of individuals. But Doñana is not just a bird reserve. On its sand and among the undergrowth of its forests, we can find an extremely wide variety of insects, amphibians, and vertebrates, whose most representative species are the lynx and the mongoose. The national park is one of the best places in Europe to observe wildlife in its natural environment. Its importance is such that it must be protected by legislation to guarantee its conservation. But the fragility of the ecosystems does not understand laws and requires constant attention, because any alteration could cause irreparable damage. It's not easy to predict how an entire ecosystem might evolve if one of its elements disappears. The balance between predators and prey, between expanses of pasture and herbivores, between fish and birds, is essential for the entire area. The lynx, for example, feeds almost exclusively on rabbits, but its absence also puts other species in serious danger. The lynx, as the king of our Iberian fauna, is feared and respected by other predators like the fox or the mongoose, which are less selective in their diets. If they proliferate, the population of other small animals would be reduced, and the food chain would be altered and eventually broken. If this happened, the ecosystems would be destroyed, and their reconstruction would be almost impossible. Today, the lynx is in extreme danger of extinction, and we will not be able to relax until its footprints once more appear in the sands of Doñana. The breeding and captivity program began in 2003. The first thing that was done was to capture a reproductive male who was called Garfio. Since then, an average of 3 individuals a year have been introduced into the center from large litters born in the wild in the communities in Sierra Morena or Doñana. The possibilities of 3 or 4 lynxes from the same litter reaching adulthood in the wild are very scarce, and therefore capturing some cubs guarantees that all of them will survive. The situation is so desperate that it is calculated that the death of a single lynx is as significant for the species as the deaths of 400,000 people would be for humanity. It is therefore not surprising that the Iberian lynxes in the breeding and captivity center are treated as unique, priceless treasures. The techniques used at the El Acebuche Center have made it possible to make considerable progress in our knowledge of these animals. And moreover, we must take into account the fact that never before had it been possible to study the Iberian lynx 24 hours a day. Thanks to this, they have accumulated a huge amount of data that have permitted great advances in the knowledge of the physiology, territoriality, habits, and sexual behavior of these felines.
The Iberian lynx is a medium-sized feline. The females weigh between 9 and 10 kilos. The males can weigh between 14 and 16 kilos. They can be about the size of a Dalmatian, except that a Dalmatian weighs more. An Iberian lynx, because it has to be very agile, is very light in weight. Considering all the variables, the territories can be between 5 and 15 square kilometers. The territory varies a lot depending on the density of rabbits. If there are a lot of rabbits, the territories are small, and if there are few rabbits, the territories are bigger. It also depends on the sex. The males have much bigger territories than the females. Normally, they hunt down one rabbit a day, except females with cubs, who have greater energy needs and can hunt up to three rabbits. That means that they have really to work hard to hunt down that number of rabbits to keep the litter going.
Food is one of the factors that has most influenced the precarious situation of the Iberian lynx. The more specific a behavior or a diet is, the more complicated it is to adapt and survive in a different environment. The lynx can, without a doubt, be considered an animal of very special tastes. The fact that the rabbit makes up 90% of the lynx's diet means that this animal's destiny is closely linked to that of its main food. It would be futile to reintroduce the lynx into a forest that is not ready to receive it, and therefore, the studies also focus on monitoring the numbers and health of rabbits in the areas where they intend to carry out this reintroduction. It is also fundamental that the lynxes know how to hunt them, as only then will they be able to fend for themselves in the wild. The work is divided into observation of the animals, the constant gathering of data, and their subsequent analyses. And as it is a completely new area of experimentation, the exchange of information with experts in other medium-sized felines, such as Eurasian lynxes or bobcats, can help to overcome certain difficulties.
Many of the techniques are being perfected here. The truth is, we are learning as we go along.
Every day, the feces of all the animals are collected. Depending on the places where these are deposited, or whether they are covered or not, many things can be learned about the animal's behavior or relations among them. The analyses of organic remains makes it possible to study them without needing to touch them or employ invasive methods. The hormones are also analyzed, and these provide valuable data on the reproductive level of each animal, which is, after all, the fundamental aspect of the project. Every attempt is made to ensure that the animals live as if they were in the wild, but it is impossible to completely avoid contacts. The most notable limitation of the center is in relation to territoriality. The areas in which the animals live are no larger than 500 square meters, which prevents them, for example, from walking 7 kilometers a day as they would normally do in the wild. In addition, contacts among them are limited, so they don't harm each other in fights.
The daily work is pretty intense because we work during the day, at night, at weekends. Well, the problem we have day by day is that there are many things that we are learning as we go along. All kinds of discoveries, for example, that the females remain in heat until the month of May, but then their ovaries are inactive for the rest of the year, whereas the males maintain testicular activity throughout the year. That the females can experience a condition of pseudo-gestation that can last for several months. Also, things that we are discovering in many different fields, ethology, their behavior. For example, a female that is pregnant can go into a kind of pseudo-heat, and it looks as if she's really in heat.
Science has achieved notable advances in recent years, and that means that dead animals can automatically be used as donors for others. Even the lynxes killed in accidents with cars can serve to save others. In this regard, the communication work done by the center is fundamental. The people in the surrounding area must know what is being done at El Acebuche and in what way they can contribute to saving the Iberian lynx. Simply informing Seprona that a lynx has been run over can be of invaluable assistance.
We have learned one important thing, which is how to bottle feed a lynx cub from when it was abandoned at just 1 day old, and we've managed to do it. It is now 5 months old and it's a very strong lynx. For us, that is a good experience because in the future there will almost certainly be other abandoned lynxes that we will have to bottle feed. We have been helped a lot by the experiences of other programs of breeding in captivity, specifically the Jerez Zoo, which rescued a female that was dying out in the countryside, just 5 days old, and they bottle fed her, and they have helped us a lot with the case of Zinara, who is the female abandoned precisely by that same mother that was bottle fed, and then also the experiences of other feline programs in captivity.
Another of the great challenges of the ex situ breeding project is the conservation of the genetic variety of the Iberian lynx. Endogamy is one of the causes of the disappearance of the lynx, and it can only be avoided by encouraging males and females from different groups to breed. Those in charge of the project estimate that until there is a population of 70 individuals in captivity, the optimum genetic variety will not be guaranteed. Of course, even the most conscientious studies are only theories, and in January 2005, the lynx breeding program faced its moment of truth. Once all the health controls and analyses have been carried out, the time had come to leave the protagonists alone. Oblivious to the expectation, Garfio and Saliega lived out an intense romance as the entire international scientific community watched on. 74 days after their first copulation, the first litter of Iberian lynxes was born in captivity. It was the first time that it was possible to see and study a complete generation, and one more step in the reintroduction of the lynx into our forests. Since the middle of the 1980s, the word ecology has increasingly become a part of our everyday vocabulary, and ecologists are no longer the agitators who chained themselves to trees and clashed with the police. The concern to know and conserve nature has become something as normal as taking a walk in the countryside. And that is what attracts thousands of people to the El Acebuche Visitor Center in Doñana Park. In the course of their visit, they can contemplate endless virgin beaches and can see thousands of birds in the wetlands. But above all, visitors to Doñana discover how the mechanisms work to produce the greatest spectacle in the world, nature. In Doñana, one of the great beneficiaries of this unstoppable tide of interest in ecology is the Iberian lynx. The explanations that visitors to the park receive help them to understand the difficulties experienced by our largest feline. Obviously, those in charge of the park are aware that too many visitors, or allowing them to move around freely, would not be positive for the environment, and so the routes are properly fenced off so that human activity does not leave a mark. People have changed their shotguns for binoculars and are learning to make the conservation of nature areas profitable. In 2010, when the reintroduction into the wild of the lynxes born in captivity begins, it will not be enough to simply ensure that the Mediterranean forests are ready to receive them again. It will be necessary for people to be aware of how fragile the balance is that permits life on our planet and how easy it is to destroy it. Only in that way will we know how to appreciate the importance of the work of the scientists at the El Acebuche Center. These are the best examples of the efficacy of the program for the breeding of Iberian lynxes in captivity. 64 days after the first copulation between Garfio and Saliega, Brezo, Brisa, and Brezina were born. The theories established by specialists in lynxes all around the world had been successfully translated into practice.
We have been in close contact with people who breed Eurasian lynxes and also Canadian lynxes and bobcats, and above all, the experiences of the Jerez Zoo in looking after Iberian lynx cubs taken from the wild. And we're also learning a lot as we go along, because the Iberian lynx is a unique animal, and there are also things that are unique in this species, and we have learned many things from the litters that were born in 2005 and those born in 2006.
The birth of three Iberian lynxes in captivity was very important news throughout the scientific community and a decisive first step towards the recovery of the species. Probably, the first effort the scientists at El Acebuche had to make was to stop staring slack-jawed. But once they had overcome that awe at being able to observe these impressive creatures, a double task began. On the one hand, the study of the behavior of the newborn cubs, because until then, there had never been an opportunity to directly observe the growth and development of a litter. And on the other hand, to take care of these real treasures whose optimum development could be key to saving the entire species. Everything was going just the way the scientists at El Acebuche wanted Until on the night of the 11th of May 2005, something terrible happened. In nature, it had been observed that some cubs died before the age of 8 weeks, but the reasons were unknown. It was believed that it could be due to a lack of food, accidents, or because the mother rejected the weakest one in the litter. But that night, what appeared to be the normal play of two cubs ended in a fight in which Britho, the male, killed his sister Brithina. It all took place so quickly that not even the mother, Saliega, was able to separate them in time. Apparently, weaning coincides with a period in which they start to become territorial, and this gives rise to episodes of extreme aggressiveness. No one could have imagined that two such beautiful and apparently defenseless cubs could have behaved that way, though sometimes it is all too easy to forget that these are wild felines. But life must go on, and in the case of the Iberian lynx, there is no time for lamentation. Until the risk of extinction of the species has disappeared, each Iberian lynx is a treasure that must be kept alive at all costs.
Here we had a female that was half dead from the wild. She was called Viciosa, and she had had a fight and she came in half dead. We had her here for 3 weeks. She recovered in January. She was released in February. She returned to the wild. She gave birth, and cubs have been born to that female. And that is an interesting example that demonstrates how this center not only tries to maintain the lynx, we also try to recover lynxes that could have died and return them to the wild so that they can continue procreating.
Since the tragic death of Brithina, 9 litters have been born in the Elacebuche Breeding and Captivity Center, and each birth is a reason for celebration that brings us closer to 2010. By then, the other phase of the project will have been completed, and the experts from the regional government of Andalusia will have determined which of the 4 forest areas they are currently studying meets the conditions of environmental health and the presence of rabbits necessary to be the habitat of the first Iberian lynxes reintroduced into the wild. Meanwhile, the scientists at Elacebuche will continue to gather data to increase their knowledge of the physiology, etiology, and reproduction of the most threatened felines on the planet. And they will continue to observe, fascinated, the development of these little creatures that are halfway between soft toys and fierce tigers, which it is impossible to stop watching. It looks as if the future will smile on the Iberian lynx. The admirable work of the breeding and captivity program, the restoration of optimum forest areas for the felines to live in the wild, and increasing public awareness will help make the dream a reality. Having reached this point, the hopes of the lynx lie with their ancestral enemies, us, human beings. The majority of the optimal areas for the reintroduction of the Iberian lynx are in private hands and are used for hunting. It might seem strange to set predators loose in an area where rabbits are hunted, but time has demonstrated that the presence of the Iberian lynx in these environments is positive. On the one hand, it prevents the proliferation of other predators such as foxes, genets, or mongooses. And in addition, it improves the rabbit populations by eliminating the weakest and thus preventing diseases from being spread. But it will not be easy. It is calculated that there are now between 150 and 200 Iberian lynxes in the wild. And the most alarming thing is that less than 10% of them are females of breeding age. In addition, many of the factors that have led to the very serious situation in which we find ourselves remains present. The figures are worrying. Between the years 2000 and 2006, in the Doñana National Park alone, 16 lynxes died.
Recently, two lynxes were run over on the roads in Doñana, which is very sad. And a lot is being done, a lot to try to improve this system of roads because many lynxes have died in recent years. But one positive thing about this worrying event was that in both cases, the driver that ran over the lynx immediately called Seprona. This is an important change of attitude because in the past they would have been afraid, but now they immediately call to tell us, I've run an animal over, I think it's an Iberian lynx, and Seprona immediately goes there.
Frequently, politics, the economy, and nature have contradictory interests, but it is vital to find solutions that benefit everyone before it is too late. Seeing a lynx in the wild is no easy matter. They are wild felines and are therefore elusive and mistrustful. However, there are still places in Spain where, with luck and patience, you can have the privilege of observing the king of Iberian fauna. The El Acebuche Ex Situ Breeding Center, the Department of the Environment of the Autonomous Community of Andalusia, and the Ministry of the Environment are combining efforts to ensure the Iberian lynx does not disappear. Seprona, the international scientific community, and numerous ecological groups are permanently monitoring the success of the project. The dream will come true in 2010, when the first cubs born in captivity are reintroduced into the wild. Before that moment arrives, it is necessary for many people to participate in this undertaking. We must involve everyone. If we don't fully realize the importance of the continued existence of the lynx, nothing will have been achieved.